Snow White is a lady of many firsts. First Disney princess, first English heroine in an animated feature. Her voice was even on the first feature film soundtrack. Snow White's animation was also a first in believability. Before her, humans were tough to animate. Disney animators were spending a great deal of time perfecting a believable human portrayal. Until one man walked into the studio from the East Coast and did what few could. Who? Let's find out. Grim Nadwick was born in Wisconsin Rapids, Wisconsin, as Mirian Nordvig. The Grim nickname came from high school as a takeoff of his anything-but-grim personality. Natwick's artistic career started with cover designs for sheet music, initially for a friend who worked at a music publishing company. In 1917, a former school friend convinced him to try animation at International Film Service Productions. After a while animating, and a few years studying art in Vienna, in 1929, Grimm joined the Fletcher Studios. Disney had just raided the studio for talent, taking several key animators. Grimm was left with a group of inexperienced, but enthusiastic and talented young artists. He quickly whipped the crew into shape and provided the Fletchers with some of the most imaginative animation ever produced at the studio. One day, Dave Fletcher handed Grimm a photograph of a singer, Helen Kane, and asked him to design a caricature. Grimm exaggerated Kane's wide eyes and rosebud mouth, creating a slightly coarse but strikingly original design. A few weeks later, Dave asked Grimm to design a girlfriend for Bimbo to star as the fair young maiden in a cartoon adaptation of the popular song Barnacle Bill the Sailor. Grimm streamlined and refined his caricature of Kane for the part, but Dave Fletcher objected, insisting that since Bimbo was a dog, his girlfriend should also be a dog. Grimm quickly sketched Betty Boop's head on a four-legged canine body. He held up the drawing next to the pretty girl design and asked, "Which would you rather have as your girlfriend, a girl or a dog?" Dave laughed and agreed that the pretty girl was the right choice. Grimm went on to work for UB Iwerks, where he was able to direct films like Jack Frost, Room Runners, Stratus Fear, and Aladdin's Lamp. But he always loved a challenge. When Grimm heard that Disney was planning a feature-length cartoon based on Snow White and the Seven Dwarves, he knew he had to be a part of it. UB offered him a full partnership in the studio to entice him to stay on, but money wasn't Grimm's primary concern. Animation was.
Iwerks was branching out, and he more or less urged me to come in as a partner, and I didn't think I was any part of a businessman, and I thought I loved animation, and so Walt was willing to put me on the staff, and so I spent the next 4 or 5 years with Disney.
Grimm's first animation for Disney was the female lead in Cookie Carnival. He received great praise from Walt for his work, and was assigned the female lead in the upcoming feature, Snow White, to animate. By the end of the picture, he had animated over 120 scenes, with 6 assistants working under him, producing as much as 35 feet of finished animation per week. Grimm's tenure at Disney was not without turmoil, however. Ham Lusk had been promised the character of Snow White before Grimm arrived at the studio, and he considered Grimm's assignment to be an incursion on his territory. Although Lusk had the directing animator credit on the film, he had little direct interaction with Natwick's unit. There was considerable tension on the lot between Walt's boys, the animators who had been with Disney for years, and the East Coast animators who had been hired for the feature. Grimm paid no mind to it, focusing on his work, but the bad feelings would eventually boil over. Grimm's assistant, Jack Campbell, showed promise and wanted to animate, so he was allowed to move to Lusk's unit as an animator. There are 3 Snow Whites in the finished picture. Lusk's, Campbell's, and Natwick's. Lusk's girl is doll-like and close in style to the female leads in Silly Symphonies. Campbell's girl showed a strong influence of rotoscope. Natwick's Snow White is the most lifelike and alive.
Oh, what adorable little bear. And look, they have their names carved on them. Doc, Happy, Sneezy, Dopey. What funny names for children.
Grimm was a better draftsman than either of the other artists and worked much faster. The lion's share of the Snow White scenes were his, and he even animated a few scenes of the witch at the climax of the film. While Grimm was putting in many hours of unpaid overtime, Dave Hand, the director, had promised him a bonus if the picture was a hit. But when the checks went around, Grimm was passed over, despite the fact that he was one of the key animators on the film. He contested the oversight with the paymaster and requested a copy of the draft to make a list of the scenes he had animated. He was disgusted to find that Lusk's name had been substituted for his own on scenes that Grimm himself had animated. When Max Fletcher called to invite Grimm to join him at his new studio in Florida, Grimm left Disney without a second thought. During World War II, Grimm returned to Hollywood to work for Walter Lantz. Lantz's friendly, family atmosphere appealed to Grimm, but he didn't become complacent. He reinvented his style to suit the brash, slapstick style of animation at the time, and succeeded in creating some of the finest animation ever produced at Lantz. Grimm's earliest work at the studio included Take Heed, Mr. Tojo, starring Hook, and Enemy Bacteria, one of the most successful wartime training films. In his autobiography, Walter Lantz cited Natwick as the best animator he had ever had the pleasure of working with. When Grimm's former assistant from Iwerks, Stephen Busuttow, convinced him to join UPA in 1950, he was 60 years old. Most animators of the generation were thinking of retirement, but not Grimm. He dove into the stylistic revolution of UPA with both feet. Grimm animated on the early Magoo cartoons, as well as one-shots like Rudy Toot Toot,
Rudy Toot Toot, right in the snoot,
and Gerald McBoing Boing.
Well, when he started talking, you know what he said? He didn't talk words. He went instead.
He animated on the first television cartoon series, Crusader Rabbit, and later took in work from Jay Ward and Bill Scott on the George of the Jungle program. He animated on Raggedy Ann and Andy cartoons with Richard Williams and traveled to the UK while working on Cobbler and the Thief. He continued to draw into his early 90s until his failing eyesight made it difficult. As animation director and author Stephen Wirth remembers, one afternoon, as I sat with Grimm on his front porch, he casually mentioned that he had been told that there were machines that animated, computers. He wondered aloud how they managed to get the machines to hold a pencil, and expressed an interest in finding out more about it. So I called my friend, Charlie Gibson, who was a partner at Rhythm & Hughes in Hollywood. Charlie showed Grimm their machine room and demo reel, and sat him down at the workstation to see how wireframe characters are posed. After a few minutes of working with the mouse, Grimm leaned back in his chair and said, "I have seen some amazing things here today that I never would have imagined possible. I don't pretend to understand everything I've seen, but I have a basic idea of what you do here. I just have one question to ask you. When I animated Snow White or Mickey Mouse, I had certain tricks to put the personality of the character across. A gesture, the raising of an eyebrow, a bit of acting. How do you do that sort of thing with a computer?" Charlie paused for a moment and replied, "Well, Grimm, you just put your finger on the thing we struggle with every day. To answer your question, we study classic cartoons to learn those secrets from great animators like you." In the space of an afternoon, at nearly 100 years old, Grimm had gone from, "How do they get the machines to hold a pencil?" to putting his finger on the main issue facing CGI animators. His mind was always nimble and able to see the challenges facing animation in the future. He was truly a remarkable man. Thank you for watching this episode of Dizographies. Click the thumbs up button below if you liked it, and if you want to be notified when the next episode comes out, consider subscribing. Comment below with characters you would like to see us cover. Further reading and references are linked in the description. We hope to see you in another Dizography.